Hello everyone, my name is Deepak Sharma. I'm a professional speaker and a communication coach. Today on Converse with Deepak, we have a very special guest. You can see on the screen, the teenager Neerja Singh. What is this teenager? I don't know, but we're going to ask Neerja about it. But before that, you should know that Neerja comes with more than 35 years of experience in education and media. She's an author, she was a teacher, she's a motivator, she's a trainer, and she calls herself Generation Mediator. I have no idea what is Generation Mediator. Let's understand from Neerja Singh herself what exactly this Generation Mediator is. So welcome Neerja on this show called Converse with Deepak.
Thank you, Deepak. I am thrilled to be conversing with you. And right away, teenager is my trademark. And I adopted it because it encompasses what I'm trying to do now with my speaking. Teenager is a senior teenager. Wow. And if you Google it, there'll be tons of definitions of teenager. But I've adopted it. And what my takeaway from the word teenager, what I'm trying to do with my work is, be a senior teenager, which means a millennial, also a zoomer in spirit, with the benefit of hindsight. That is teenager Neerja Singh.
And don't worry that Neerja not only talk about being a teenager, she is actually a teenager. I saw her dancing. My God. She can beat anybody in cycling, in dancing, and I don't know many things. You need to be with her to know that part of Neerja. Neerja, with all these interesting things behind you and a background with forces, the audience would like to know a little bit more about you and what motivated you to pick up this unique subject, being a teenager.
Yes, Deepak, there's a story to it. Okay. My background is true. It's in education and media. I'm an armed forces daughter, armed forces sister, armed forces wife. Wow. We have four generations in the armed forces. Our fifth is now in the armed forces. So that is the armed forces background. Extremely, extremely proud of the lifestyle and the values and the belief system of the armed forces that has influenced me greatly. So that is one part of it. The second part is because of my background in teaching, I would be a lot in touch with the younger generation. And third, when my daughters, I have two daughters, when they turned teenagers and they got into professional schools, I began to see the disconnect happening. It was happening with us personally, my husband and I. We used to think that we are very progressive parents. Mm-hmm. But I realized gradually that this next generation, and particularly in India, is acquiring a vocabulary we have no connection with. And in fact, we lacked the imagination to go where they were going. So we were seeing things that were hitting us between the eyes, one after another, after another. And the biggest concern was there should not be a break in communication, because as children begin to get distant, more young people today are joining professional schools, they're going abroad. My younger one went to Princeton. She was away for 8 years, working, doing a bridge year program. It was a different culture, different value system. Indian society is still very, very conservative and traditional in many ways. And when I saw the disconnect, there was a desire to address it. You cannot withdraw from it. You cannot fight it, but you definitely must engage with it, because this is a question of sustainability, survival, connections, bonds between generations. The next generation needs us as much as we need them. That's my belief. And that's why I started writing about what are the differences, what are we contesting or what are we dissenting over, and what can we do to better understand each other. That brought me to this word empathy, generational mediation. So, all right, let's get to the table, because notoriously, Deepak, Indian parents are not used to listening. That's a skill we are gradually now learning. And listening means not just hearing, you understand? Listening with empathy. And that is where that generational mediator came in.
Absolutely. And you are bang on, because I also have two daughters, and I can relate what you are saying just now, that we think that we are progressive, but you are absolutely right. They are talking different language. Yes. And I have heard, and I'm going to ask you this question straight. I have heard from a lot of kids, especially today's kids, my brother's kid who is like 18 years old at this point of time, whenever some discussion is happening and this one word is coming up very commonly while they are having this discussion, communication, dad, this is a generation gap.
Yes.
You don't understand. And how parents should handle this situation, and how if young children, and especially the so-called Zoomers, you know, the Generation Z, should also, not only parents should empathize with them, and they should also empathize vice versa.
Yes. See, Deepak, I do believe that human history in the normal course of event goes round a full circle. You start with something, then there's a reaction against that, then things settle down, then there's a reaction with the next generation. That's how we've gotten where we are today. That is one. So what is happening is not unusual or unexpected. This kind of an, you know, anti-authority, anti-establishment, anti-earlier generation thing is bound to happen. It's very normal. And that's what people mean when they say, oh, we've always seen generation gap. This has always been there. But the difference today is the stakes. Never have the stakes been higher in the context of generation gap. We are losing our mind. We are losing our lives in extreme cases, only because two generations are not able to come to the table and appreciate what the other generation is experiencing. So that lived experience is not resonating with each other. That makes it very, very important, because I will go so far as to say, Deepak, that the only context today is generational, because all this talk of progress and science and future, what good is it if the next generation is not stronger, more potent, more productive than the earlier generation? That's been the mandate with every generation. You leave behind a generation which is in many ways bigger, better, broader than you. So you stop and ask yourself, are the next, the young people today as healthy, as resilient? Are their choices as sustainable? And there I contest this normal, very accepted kind of, you know, belief. It's there, nobody questions it. We all say that the next generation is very smart. I would like to just voice a note of caution there. Stop and ask yourself, what exactly does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
So these are a few premises that I base my work upon. Another major difference, you're sitting in the United States, I'm in India, I'm sitting in Mohali. Now, there are certain values that we call global.
Absolutely.
And which are considered as the norm. Nobody again stops to question those. But the reality, what is the reality? I can talk about my reality, my Indian reality. A young Indian today wants to be a global citizen, most certainly, but the connection with their family, with their roots, with their parents is still humming. It's still humming. It's very difficult for a young Indian today, even at 20, 23, 24, to just say, all right, this is my life, that's your life, you get yourselves a life, and I'm on my own. And, all the talk about individuality, about personal choices, about privacy, about personal spaces, this language is new at the moment to India. And India, you know, Deepak, it's such a diverse space. So there are classes and classes and societies and cultures. The same, what I'm saying is not applicable across the board. I'm primarily talking about the educated urban Indians, even for them, even for the Ivy League educated, the top 1% percentile, whatever that percentile is still connected. It goes very, very deep. So they would like to be a part of the global setup. And yet there is that traditional inertia where they're finding very difficult to break away from. That is what is happening here right now.
You're absolutely right. And rather, I was till a few years back, I used to hear this one word, and we all have heard this one word, Generation Y, millennials. Okay. And now it is Generation Z, the Zoomers. Okay, now what next? There's nothing after Z.
Alpha.
Where are we going?
We go back to Alpha. Yes, the generation that's going to come after Generation Z will be called Alpha. But Deepak, very interestingly, in between, a new generation has been thrown up just because of the way we are living today. That generation you would call the Generation I. The world has become flat because of connectivity. And on the internet, across Zoom, it doesn't matter what age you are.
Absolutely.
And multiple people, each of us today, presents multiple personalities. So I'm one person on Instagram, I'm another person on Facebook, I'm another person on Twitter, I'm another person on Twitch, or the multiple. Some of us could be on Snapchat for all you know. I'm not, I tried. I just wanted to see what app goes on in Snapchat because of my interest in generational work. But that's a new generation. So here with this generation that is on the internet, your gender, your class, your age, creed doesn't matter because you're connecting on mutual interests. So that is one generation. We are talking about a generation which is still majorly in the physical world, functioning in the physical world, to some extent on the internet. And yes, the next generation is Alpha. It will go on and on. And who's to say in future there'll be a cyborg man and machine interface with that, you know, be already happening.
No.
So interesting times.
Absolutely. And this particular point brought me to a very interesting thing. My subject is communication and speaking. And when I see a lot of, especially Generation Z, so-called, is struggling and building a relationship online, communicating online, doing everything online. But when they come to handle those difficult conversations one-to-one, I see them facing challenges. How do we make sure, or how parents or people who are connected to them, or teachers or professors who are responsible for making this generation responsible? Because ultimately, for example, I was reading an article of an organization called Pew Research, and they wrote this year in 2020, 23 million Generation Y people, or I would call it kids or young people, have voted in America's election. 23 million means they were the one who actually attained an age of 23 or 20, 22, whatever it is, the age for election is. But now as we grow in coming years, more and more Generation Z people will be adding into this, and they will be responsible for creating this new world. And one thing which is very important is communication. But everything is happening online. How do we help them, or what they need to do to make sure they are able to handle those difficult conversations when they go to corporate world?
Here, Deepak, it's not a question of what they can do. It will finally be a question of what we can do.
Yeah.
What the older generation can do. Because it is here that the onus lies. It is on us parents, managers, communicators, life coaches. It's on us to understand what their challenges are. And we no longer have the luxury of just being prescriptive, just laying down. Things have to be more consultative. Things have to be more conversational, because unless we know the challenges they are facing. For example, if my daughter tells me that she is anxious about the climate, I find it difficult to empathize there, because I've not been anxious about climate when I was her age. And when she recommends that in the new house we are constructing, why are we not putting down bunkers because the climate is collapsing and apocalypse is going to happen? Why are we not taking her seriously? There's a problem there. We are not able to grasp the gravity of her anxiety, the reality of her anxiety. Therefore, it's important for the earlier generation to really understand what is actually happening with them. And for that, there has to be talking, there has to be a conversation, that has to be a listening. That is not happening. And the younger generation, because of the education, they will only listen to reason, to logic, to a rational. So even when you're, whatever you are recommending to them, say, this is the way you ought to communicate. This is the kind of communication that is likely to get you outcomes, successful outcomes. They would like to know the rationale behind it. And unfortunately, we are not equipped. We haven't equipped ourselves. I think it's a major failing with my generation that we have not offered the next generation a viable alternative. We really cannot blame them, because consider how important objectivity and scientific approach has been in their upbringing, in their education. We as parents have not insisted that they learn their provincial, regional language. We've not kept them close to their roots. Yes. In fact, many of them on their own now are turning in that direction. They are discovering the restorative nature of belonging, or the power of having an identity, a local identity. So these are things that they're discovering on their own. We haven't provided them this alternative, this kind of a narrative. So today, whatever recommendation is happening from us has to happen with some kind of a reason and logic. That's the only way it's going to be accepted. And it's so important, this connection, that it's worth it to put in that kind of work. So that's what I believe.
Before I move to the next part of our conversation, I would like you to give one strong message to the parents or teachers or the one who is responsible for helping this Gen Z. What would be your one message to them so that we make this generation very responsible in coming times?
The primary message would be to maintain that connection with the next generation. And even if it involves you going more than halfway, they need, the younger generation definitely needs us. They need the earlier generation. And so keep that connection alive. What I say, keep that door half open, quarter open, and the light in the portico on all the time. Yes. So the young generation may break away. They may say that they don't need you. It may happen also that they break away and follow a path to discover their own identities and gain their sense of self, which is all right. But for my generation, it's important to always be in the wings, to be in the stand, you know, on a standby mode and be available. But they say, Deepak, that if this next generation can be at their worst with them, if my child is comfortable enough to be with me, around me, even when they are at their worst, that is a test of the nurturing that we are doing. Mm-hmm. And currently, yes, currently Gen Z is facing challenges because we know what the challenges are with what we've seen in the recent part, the job market, the financial insecurity, you know, the lack of trust in the institutions. So there's a lot that is scaring them, causing them anxiety.
And I think the first biggest challenge they will tell their kids, we face this pandemic as soon as we entered 23 or 22 years of age.
Absolutely. Absolutely. This is will define their the life to come, certainly.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Thank you, Nirja. Now, moving to the second part about your professional speaking journey. I know you've been a teacher, you've been an author, you've been played so many roles in your life. How come you decided to jump into this whole journey of professional speaking?
Deepak, as a teacher, I used to conduct workshops, seminars for the teachers, for the students. And as an Air Force wife, there was an opportunity to talk to the Air Force wives, they're called Sanghinis, about different issues. So there were these awareness workshops happening. I liked being in front of an audience. I liked, enjoy that limelight and the energy exchange that happens with the listeners. For instance, there's an energy exchange happening with you right now and with anybody who's watching it. Yeah. I loved that. And it used to end well, and then people would contact me and then say, you know, that this really touched them. That was happening. And I realized that perhaps there's an aptitude. This is something I like doing. And when I came across PSAI, I happened to attend PSAI's Professional Speakers Association of India. That's the time I discovered that there's this entire community. I did not know until then that there is a community of professional underlying speakers and who are constantly working to present themselves on the stage with a message. And I jumped at it and I felt this is my tribe. This is the place I'm most comfortable with. Here are these people who love, you know, in love with their voices and they write and they speak. And that's how I jumped headlong into it, Deepak. This happened a year ago when I first attended the Professional Speakers Summit in Delhi.
Just for my audience, Nirja is part of Professional Speakers Association of India, and she is also president of PSCI Delhi chapter. Am I right, Nirja?
Yes, you're right.
And she is leading Delhi chapter to new heights with a lot of initiatives and helping a lot of new professional speakers build their strength into particular areas. So Nirja, India is very new speaking journey. I would not say very new in terms of speaking, because there have been many speakers, but I have seen till now their speakers were celebrity speakers or speakers who were just into some part, or they have experience in the corporate world, and then they come into and they start speaking. But there was no career sort of speaking for people who wanted to take this journey of becoming a professional speaker. Now, being a president of PSAI, I would like you to share with audience, if they want to take up this journey of professional speaking, do they need to have some kind of qualification, or you can just decide and start this journey on their own at any age?
That's a multi-million dollar question, because in India at the moment, most of the members who are with the PSAI do multiple things. So they're very few. In fact, somebody who just speaks, only speaks and nothing else, that's rare at the moment. Absolutely. But there are people who are working towards it. That's for sure. A number of things that I personally feel about the way things are happening here. We are taking our cues from the West, from the global market, because they are more advanced in their technology, in their fee is a big factor, Deepak, because any work that you take up in India has to be conversion. There has to be that's what you call a professional speaker, right?
Yeah.
So, but what's happening in India is that the perception of a speaker as just a speaker, there is a tendency to mix it up with, maybe this is a life coach, maybe this is, okay. The only term that really goes down very strongly, which generally masses understand, is a motivational speaker. Yeah. That is understood. But a speaker, a niche speaker on a particular category with a particular expertise, is something that is still evolving. I think we'll get there, but I do feel that we have to be careful, because we, as a speaker, are responsible. There's a responsibility there also, Deepak. I do believe that you should not lose touch with what are the local needs, what are the local issues. We are taking our cues from the global market. So you talk about, setback leadership, or you talk about being a world-class expert. You talk about being a productivity explorer or an outlier marketer. There are also some very, very distinct local issues which could be taken up. I don't think we are exploring that, because there is the focus is professional speaking. And well, dollars, let's say, dollars or pounds or whatever, that's a big thing, because a fees just as a keynote speaker, it's too exclusive, and that kind of fees is not materializing at the moment. That is what is happening.
Okay, so I think what you're trying to say, because as I see in US, a motivational speaker concept is not there, because
Motivational speaker concept is the only concept that people usually understand. I'm talking about the Indian market.
But here, people have more, especially in the National Speakers Association, people are more focused on, as you said, you are on focusing on one lane. Similarly, people are very much focused on one subject specialization. There are a lot of local issues that can be picked up by speakers, which will really help India per se in a big way. What is one thing that, for example, there are a lot of trainers in India. India is big training industry. There is a formalized training industry. There is a not so formalized training industry. There are training organizations. There are individual trainers. And a lot of trainers want to expand or branch themselves into professional speaking. Is it a good idea for them?
Yes, I think today it's a good idea to be multifaceted and not put all your eggs in one basket, so to say, because things are evolving so much. There are professions going out of fashion, or they're not needed anymore, or professions getting redundant. So for a speaker, I personally think that you should be versatile. You should be able to address a lot of issues out there, definitely, Deepak. And just to answer one more question you had asked me earlier, do you need a qualification to be a speaker? They say, I heard a speaker said it was Vikas Jain, who is the past president of PSAI Delhi chapter. He said that this is a good thing and a bad thing about speaking. One is that you don't need a qualification. So it works both ways. It's good in a way. It's bad in a way. Your life lived so far, a strong message, a desire to communicate or bring a change, those are the qualifications, and agility to learn quickly. For instance, I learned OBS. I got a little comfortable with OBS recently, OBS Studio. So there's new technology, and you have the stamina to keep pace, because it's easy to begin to feel, oh my God, I can't keep up with this. I'm falling behind. And, somebody else is using the green screen differently, or they're standing in front of a moving picture behind. So these things are happening very fast. That stamina, sustainability, that is important. If you have that quality, willingness to learn, spend time, certainly this is the space for you.
You used one word, desire to change, desire to impact. And can you just elaborate on this?
What I mean by that, Deepak, is when a speaker stands on the stage, you know that this speaker has got, he's saying something which is really coming from deep down within him. You sense that, that life force, that kind of deep desire to bring about a difference. I think that's a speaker's fundamental responsibility, no matter what niche or what your area of expertise is, but you have to leave the stage with having impacted your listeners. You have to leave them something. So that is the change I'm talking about. Leave a message, leave a shift in their mind, leave them questioning themselves.
Absolutely.
That is the change.
You are not there for yourself, you're there for somebody else who is there.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Thank you so much, Neerja, for giving us so much information of what's happening in PSAI India, and also on our Generation Y and Generation Z, who is like struggling with so many things. I think I would like to summarize our conversation, Neerja, with, I would like to request all the parents, especially parents who are dealing with their young kids day in and day night, and keep on thinking that I used to be like this way. Guys, time has changed. Time has changed. You have to now become teenager, and then only you will be able to interact with teenagers. You have to communicate with them. You have to talk to them. And the best thing that Neerja said just now, listen to them, and rather go a step further. Listen to them with a lot of empathy so that you understand them. You can take decision by giving them logics and reasons. They will be walking with you hand to hand. It's very, very important. You will see amazing change in your kids once you start understanding them and talk to them by putting yourself into their shoes.
Yes.
Thank you, Neerja. Any last word for our audience?
Last word, Deepak, is that may we all acquire and maintain a pulsating connection with the next generation, because like I said, that we need them, they need us, and all of you aspiring speakers there, Professional Speakers Association of India is the place to join up, come add value to us, we add value to you.
Thank you so much. I heard this one line from one speaker. He said, connection before correction. It's
absolutely
very, very important. Thank you, Neerja, for coming on this show. And guys, keep on watching this show. We will be getting many more speakers in coming time who will be like Neerja with a lot of experience. Thanks, Neerja, a lot for coming on Converse with Deepak.
Thank you, Deepak, for inspiring us. Thank you.
Bye-bye.